You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk, or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
Do you need a car? Been shopping only to be turned down because of bad credit, low credit, no credit, bankruptcy, or divorce? Guess what? Today's your lucky day, because now you can buy a car, truck, or SUV, just about any vehicle. It's true. Bad credit? Doesn't matter. No credit? Doesn't matter. Bankruptcy or divorce? It just doesn't matter. As a matter of fact, your job is your ticket to your new vehicle. We're Auto Credit Express, and we've helped thousands of people just like you. Antonio H. told us, great company, got me connected, and the day I went in, I drove off in the car I wanted. 100% worth your time. Need a car? Get started now and drive off as early as today. Just text FINANCE, F-I-N-A-N-C-E, to 357-911 right now to get started. That's FINANCE, F-I-N-A-N-C-E, to 357-911. Auto financing the easy way. Text FINANCE to 357-911.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Everyone loves liberty. Our rights come from God, not the government. So why are you letting other people tell you what's best for your health care? Exercise your freedom with Liberty HealthShare. Liberty HealthShare is a community of people who voluntarily share one another's medical costs. Liberty HealthShare is founded on the idea that most people truly want to help one another. Healthcare sharing allows members to do just that as a true community that supports one another in times of need. Liberty believes people should make decisions for themselves and their families. Members are able to take back the freedom to make their own decisions about their health care. Freedom from guilt or doubt about how your money is used. You have the freedom to direct your health care, not to be dictated to by bureaucrats. Stop letting others tell you what to do and join a community of like-minded people. Exercise your freedom. Join Liberty HealthShare and take back the control of your health care while helping those around you. Call Liberty at 855-58-LIBERTY. Again, that's 855-58-LIBERTY for more information, or you can check them out at libertyhealthshare.org. Again, that's libertyhealthshare.org.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
At St. Jude, a family never sees a bill at all. It's like the world has been lifted off of your shoulders.
St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. Finding cures, saving children. Learn more at stjude.org.
Sometimes writers feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
First things first, I'ma say all the words inside my head. I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh, ooh, the way that things have been.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Rick Robinson, programming director here at KLRNradio.com. Typically, this is where you would hear the Jen and Rick show. However, this opening is dedicated to everybody's favorite tweet stormer. You know who you are. Anyway, we have a roundtable going on tonight. We have a lot of folks with us this evening. I'm going to let you guys go around the table and introduce yourselves. Ladies first, starting with Stacy, please.
Okay, this is Stacy Lennox, also known as at Scott's Fire, S-C-O-T-S, or S-C-O-T-S-F-Y-R-E on Twitter. That's me.
Jen, are you still there?
All right, and I'm Ben Crystal, host of Last Pod on the Right, you can hear right here on KLRN, and I am at Bennett Truth, two E's, two N's, three T's, not in a row, on Twitter.
That was interesting. I've never heard anybody do that way. All right, go ahead, Jen. We kind of cut you off a second ago because we didn't hear you at first, I don't think.
No, it's fine. I mean, this is typically our hour, so I figure most people know me. I'm Jen at Jay Homestead on Twitter, and founder of Atmosfits Politics.
One of the best websites out there, especially for like Wednesdays and Friday nights on Twitter. All right, and we also have a very special guest, someone who, if you guys have been around on KLRN Radio or K90A Talk for a while, you might recognize this voice here in a minute. He actually did a very, very well-known podcast that he has on a hiatus right now. I'm going to let him introduce himself because I always butcher his last name.
That's okay. Hey, everybody. Gene Berardelli. I used to be somebody on the radio, but now I'm taking some time off to smell the roses, as it were. I have absolutely nothing to promote whatsoever, so we might as well just get right down to it.
Well, if you ever decide to bring the show back, I've already told you this. You have a home for as long as I have lights on, so just let me know.
Oh, that's very sweet of you. I appreciate that. We'll never say never, but we'll see.
Yeah, I know. You're like off doing like pizza exploration with Marco and stuff, so I understand.
Yeah, pizza exploration
doing
with my
what?
And pizza? Did he say pizza exploration?
Oh, let's explain that real quickly. So I know we got limited time here. When I moved to Long Island in the beautiful People's Republic of New York, I moved with my 6-year-old nephew. He's now 7 years old. And in order to make the move better for him, I put him in charge of finding the best pizzeria in the new neighborhood we were moving to. He literally found every single pizzeria within like a 10-mile radius, and we have been traveling to every one of them ever since.
That's cool, though.
Oh, yeah, it was a great icebreaker for him.
Yeah, Gene's actually, he's still technically in our station chat room. He's just almost never on Twitter. He spends most of his time on Facebook now, and that's where I see a lot of his posts about his pizza exploration. So, and I saw him kind of talking about the Mueller report today, and I was like, you know what? It just dawned on me. You and I have never done a show together, even though we have been on a lot of networks and a lot of stations in common. We've never actually been on the air at the same time. We should fix that. And he's like, cool, what time? So
cool.
Absolutely. You know, it's a once in a blue moon opportunity for everybody. You're welcome.
And he's a lawyer.
Don't see, Why you gotta do that? I was
because
you have valid commentary today, Gene.
I was just getting people to like me. I was getting a nice impression, and then you gotta tell them I'm a
lawyer. I've also met you multiple times, and you're an absolute sweetheart.
Well, you know, I am adorable, so I can't help that.
So you're one of the good lawyers, not one of the Avenatti lawyers.
I mean, okay. If that's the bar we're setting, then absolutely.
How many park benches is your face on right now? I guess would be the next question.
None. Absolutely none whatsoever. We do not chase ambulances at my firm. The law office of Jerry Gross in Cedarhurst, New York. We represent clients in New York, throughout the New York City and Long Island area.
Very cool.
Mister, I have nothing to promote. Just plugged his law firm.
Irony, Rick. It's called irony.
I'm just messing with you, man. I was gonna have you plug
the
law firm.
Explain the joke to everyone. They lose their funniness.
Oh, I was just messing with you. But anyway, all right. So I don't know. So we've done the introductions. I just have to say, I have not been able to keep up with this as much as I would have liked today. I have looked at a couple of in-depth areas where it kind of goes into the report. One of the biggest focus I had was, I believe it was somewhere around page 154, where Mueller kind of broke down why he balked on pushing obstruction, because he said...
Because he's a wuss.
He found several instances of what could be considered obstruction, but he wasn't sure he could find any intent.
So I read the whole thing myself, and I read the things that they were talking about, Trump and obstruction. I'm like, no, that's just Trump. Trump is a businessman. He was pissed. That's how businessmen act. And then when you listen to people way smarter than I am, and like who are attorneys like Gene, you know, Andrew McCarthy, Ben Shapiro are both looking at it. Intent is critical to the crime of obstruction. So you have to intend to try to stop an investigation or interfere in a judicial or, you know, legal process for that to hold. You can lie to the press. You can lie on your Twitter feed. You can call your attorney a rat. None of those are obstruction. Right?
I think we can agree that if... after nearly $40 million in 2+ years, if Mueller, especially under the pressure and scrutiny he was operating, had an opportunity to go with an obstruction or really any charge that he could bring out of it, he would have done so.
Well, after all the lawyers I listened to today, they're saying Section 1, done. There was no collusion, nothing. They're saying Section 2 seems almost deliberately set up to leave the door open for the House of Representatives to begin impeachment hearings.
Well, you heard Hoyer today say they're not going to do it.
Oh, Hoyer said it? Pelosi?
They trotted it. Well, I figure they probably trotted Hoyer out because everybody knew whoever had to break the bad news to the rage mob was going to get dragged all over the place. So,
she
probably told Hoyer, you do it. I don't want to
do it, dude.
People are crazy.
They drew straws.
Political reasons for that. We can get into that in a second. But I just want to touch on something that Stacey said. There is a well-known idea in the law about burdens of proof. We kind of talked about that a lot with the Kavanaugh hearings. And, you know, you have to meet a certain standard or level of proof in order for a charge to be made and to stick, really. And, you know, we call that like prima facie burden, right? So one of the elements of that prima facie burden for obstruction is the intent of the person. What is in their state of mind? And the only way you know that is through the manifestation of their actions, right? So at this point, you have to look at Trump's actions and say, what was he thinking? Now, to think that about 18 Democrat lawyers can get into the mind of Donald Trump and know what he's thinking about at any given time, is the chance that happens probably less than zero. So you have to go by the totality of the circumstances. And when you see things like his frustration over his legacy of being president, or his anger at not getting his agenda forward, and all they're going to be talking about is Russia, that calls into question whether or not his intent is actually that frustration or if it's something more nefarious. Now, Democrats thinking about what they would be doing would obviously go to the nefarious. They just can't believe that this guy would actually care enough to, I don't know, set aside his billion-dollar industry in his 70s, run for public office, and actually do what he says he's going to do.
That's a great point, Gene. No, they can't see their way to that. And everybody on this podcast, with the exception of maybe Gene and, well, and I guess Ben, because we've just met, I didn't vote for Trump in 2016. But the more I see about this and the more I listen to somebody like Devin Nunes or Andrew McCarthy or Kimberly Strassel or people who know way more about the intelligence community and prosecutorial conduct than I do, I want to understand. So if Peter Strzok, and everybody can go back and verify me if you would like to, Peter Strzok texts his lover Lisa Page, and this was found by Mike Horowitz during his last investigation, and he's doing another one, so stay tuned. If Peter texted Lisa, there's no there in collusion before Mueller was ever appointed. Why was Mueller appointed? And nobody seems to know the answer to that question. That bugs me.
I would assume that you would need to look at somebody like Comey in those circumstances and say, what role did he have, since he was clearly playing both sides against the middle right up until the last moment?
Well, not just that, but you have to look at Rosenstein. He wrote the authorization. Congress has asked for it multiple times before they lost control of the House. Nunes and the Judiciary Committees, or both intelligence committees, excuse me, and nobody will give them an unredacted scope memo. I want to know what the scope of what Mueller was supposed to be investigating was, because this team actually came in and ruined people's lives. George Papadopoulos, Carter Page, Paul Manafort. And I'm not a big Paul Manafort fan. I thought he was skeevy the day he came to the Trump campaign. Okay. And his Ukrainian connections were all out there online if you ever cared to look. Right. But the Podestas were caught up in that. I mean, if you look at the full scope of people, you know, General Flynn, if you look at the full scope of people who were pressured, caught in perjury traps, you know, just completely run over a barrel in the pursuit of what? I would like to know what they were pursuing. These are all American citizens.
I mean, you're asking a lot right now. I mean, for a lot right now. Come on now. Habeas corpus? I mean, come on. How dare you? How dare you want to know what the government knows? Who are you?
I'm still back on why Samantha Powers was unmasking people. I don't have answers to questions that I'm super interested in.
Some of these questions, I would suggest you need to prepare yourself that you may never get the answers, because the Democrats obviously don't want to share what they know. And let's be honest, the Republicans in the House, in the Senate as well, by and large, haven't demonstrated enough spine to say, we're going to go around you guys and let people understand what happened.
Don't Lindsey Graham 2.0, Ben. Don't you do that.
don't use Lindsey Graham 2.0, but also understand that there is a new sheriff in town. And that's the new attorney general, who's already been making waves on all these points. He wants to know certain things as well.
Can we get applause?
You want applause?
If I had any.
I want applause. I want applause for Attorney General Barr. I have a total political crush on that man right now. He actually replaced my political crush on Mick Mulvaney. So
wait. Crush, you say?
Giggity, 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 giggity. Let's have sex.
I did
not like that. Not like that at all. Now it's weird. All I'm saying is, here was my thing. 2 weeks, like, as Barr was going through his confirmation hearings, I do a podcast called The Loftus Party. I said to my podcast partner, if Barr gets confirmed, the Mueller report will be over. He does not want an attorney general overseeing him. What happened?
Well,
That if they had not placed an attorney general, that investigation would be ongoing.
Except that,
you know, as according though to you know, this little, it seemed almost like a memo that went out amongst Democrats and even the media. You know, this whole thing about, well, we can't trust Barr because he's Trump's guy and he's handpicked, and like, you know, Gillibrand's saying today, like, we can't trust him because he's the handpicked AG, and they kind of all latched onto this thing, which they've done all along with any of
his. But every AG is handpicked.
Of course it is. It's like every single one is handpicked by the sitting president. It's just partisan crap, you know. Yes, and so they're
every AG, their wingman of their president. That's what I want to know.
They're consistently acted like Trump, you know, choosing his own cabinet and staff is somehow, you know, evidence of malfeasance in and of itself. Like, other presidents didn't have any say, and some group of approved experts were like pulling it out of a hat in the back room.
Yeah, I mean, that's just the logical trick that they play. Trump is bad, therefore everything he does is bad, and everyone who has connected to him is bad, and they don't have to explain it. They can say, how do you know Barr is a bad guy? Because he's Trump's guy. That has to happen for them.
Right.
Absolutely right. Fruit of the poisonous tree. His presidency is illegitimate because he really didn't win, because we really didn't screw it up. Therefore, everything that he does is bad. Absolutely correct.
That's the reality of it. Is it's been 2.5 years, and all of this is a result of the fact that Hillary Clinton lost, and they can't deal.
And I don't want to hold any buzz that Stacey has with Barr, but I just want to point out something that really hasn't been talked about. And that's Barr's rehabilitation of Rod Rosenstein. If anybody noticed during his preamble and his introduction at the press conference that happened today, he went out of his way to talk about Rod Rosenstein and how good it was to work with him and how he didn't have to stay on because he was planning on resigning soon, and how integral he was in his transition to, you know, into his job as Attorney General. And he really went out of his way to rehabilitate Rod Rosenstein.
What do you think motivated that?
I didn't take it that way at all.
I'll tell you exactly what it is. Rod Rosenstein gave the Attorney General cover on the obstruction of justice, prosecutorial discretion.
Absolutely.
And in exchange for giving him that cover, because it's not just Attorney General Barr saying it, it's the savior of the Republic, Rod Rosenstein, saying it too. Therefore, it must be okay because he's been on this since day one. In exchange for that.
Yeah, exchange for what?
Rehabilitated his image. He gets to be put out to pasture with honor. He'll get to keep his pension and all the things that you come to expect from being a well-respected upper echelon member of the Justice Department, who you should have had faith in to begin with.
There's two things that I actually think Barr did intelligently. Ask Rosenstein to stay. Ask Rosenstein to buy in to his findings. And I don't know that Rosenstein didn't believe them himself, right? So I can't read that man's mind. But that's the same guy who is being touted as the guy who wanted to wear a wire on a 25th Amendment charge, right? And was the guy who wrote Mueller's original scope. So to have him weigh in at the end, I don't blame Barr for wanting that.
But he's also the same guy who has exposure on the FISA applications.
Yes, he is.
So Stacey, your estimation, this isn't a rehabilitation as much as it was a perp walk, in a sense.
Well, not even a perp walk. I actually like William Barr enough to think it was him sticking his thumb in his nose and going, take that left. Here's your dude. He agrees with me.
Nice.
That's my take, because the other take I have is he also asked Mueller's team and said explicitly this morning in his press conference that the only people involved in the redaction was a subset of his own team and a subset of Mueller's team that redacted the report together. So Mueller wasn't there. Barr wasn't there. It was the attorneys actually working on it, and Mueller's attorneys who were familiar with the case, familiar with the grand jury, familiar with the ongoing investigations, and neither he nor Mueller touched it after the fact. So the fact that he had the Mueller team involved plus Rod Rosenstein kind of built a wall around him that it's not just Trump's dude here.
But that would, well, that, and that actually sounds very accurate and astute, but I got to add that in order for that to be the case, then Mueller has to know he's going to be under the bus with them as far as the rage mob is concerned within about 24 hours. Because if doesn't come out and refute that and refute, and I think you're right about Barr's motivations, but if Mueller never comes out and refutes that, then that's an admission that, Barr is correct. There wasn't a there. And that will put Mueller,
Mueller's going to get Comey.
He's going to get hammered.
Mueller's going to get Comey. They used to buy prayer candles and T-shirts about him, and he's going to get pilloried before all this is done. Because what did Mueller do when BuzzFeed made an inaccurate report? He came out and said,
Yeah, he stomped.
That didn't happen. If he doesn't come out after today and say, I don't agree with what just went on, his silence speaks volumes.
Mueller is not going to come out and say anything right now because Mueller is currently an employee of the Department of Justice. If you were watching during the press conference and you were following along to the question and answers at the end, someone asked the Attorney General whether or not he would allow Mueller to testify before Congress. Mm-hmm. His answer was very telling. His answer was, I have no objection to the special counsel speaking in his personal capacity, meaning he will not authorize him to speak in any capacity for the Department of Justice. He is going to control the information. He is the voice. He is the only voice. He is the only person who will be talking on behalf of the department on this whole investigation.
What if Mueller resigns?
Mueller resigns. He's still bound. He's still duty bound by his confidentiality.
The same. That won't save him from a congressional subpoena, and I'm sure Schiff would do it.
But he wouldn't want to go to jail over doing that. It would save him from a subpoena because he would still have to get authority from the Department of Justice to speak on it. Again, the department. The memo didn't go to Congress. The memo went to the Attorney General. The Attorney General is in control of the department and, by extension, the special counsel's office and appointment, all the day-to-day stuff, the budget, and all that stuff. There is no way that he is going to let go of control of this now that he has put his stamp on the whole conclusion of it.
Will he be able to weather what, because that being the case, you're going to end up with Schiff and Pelosi and the rest of them making an enormous amount of noise about Barr hiding Mueller from them. Will he be able to weather the storm? Will he be able to say, no, I'm going to stay and keep control of this? Or will there be a moment when it gets so loud that he has to say, all right, Mueller, you're headed to Capitol Hill?
We are talking about an old school, lifelong Washingtonian who has been involved in high levels of the government for over 3 decades. Yeah, I think he'll be okay.
So he doesn't sweat none of that.
Facetiously, but he probably knows where a lot of the bodies are buried in a political sense. Not that I think that he would, you know, cash in a chit here and there, but I think the man has surveyed the territory for a good long while now, and he has a lot of Republican allies that may not necessarily be Donald Trump allies that I think would come if he called.
Well, and not just that, if you looked at the whole tenor, like, I heard a lot of people saying, you know, Barr didn't need to do the press conference. I'm not sure why he did it. I knew why he was doing it before he did it, and it was because of the Democratic attacks up to this point. He wanted to make very clear what was redacted, why it was redacted, what conclusions were there, and his theory of obstruction. I mean, it couldn't have been any more clear. And then he had the added, you know, fun, if you will, because I find it fun, of smacking around some stupid teenagers in the press corps.
I have to admit,
my
favorite line,
my favorite line in the whole thing was that young blonde woman, and I don't know her name, and I don't care.
From CBS, she's
the one about the president.
Yeah, when she said, "And you seem to be very," and da 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 da. He's like, "Actually, what I just said was a summary of what was in the Mueller report, and it's all reflected in there. But you said unprecedented." He said, "Is there a precedent?" She said, "No." Said, so that's the definition of unprecedented. You know, the other one
that one
just
was
like
great.
That was awesome. I like, I'm just sitting there, I'm like, I like you, I like you so much better than Sessions. Anyway, the other one that cracked me up, gosh, what was it? Oh, when he was saying, when the soy boy asked him, well, this is Robert Mueller's report, and why isn't he here? It's not Robert Mueller's report. It's my report. He works for me. I was like,
I'm
yes! Boom!
we remember a time over the last couple of years, or ever really, that the media objected to more communication from the administration? I mean, normally they whine about how seldom they see Trump. Have a chance to ask him questions in a setting that they control. And then here comes Barr and he says, we're going to have a press conference, and they're outraged. And I'm like, hey, I thought this is what you guys wanted.
Oh, I would love to talk about the media reaction to this as soon as we're done with talking about the Attorney General himself.
That's Abramson.
But for me, I think the best moment for me was the sweet, delicious irony of the Attorney General saying the equivalent of no reasonable prosecutor would be able to get a conviction on under these facts. It dripped with irony to me of flashing back to James Comey saying that about Hillary Clinton. And now the left has to swallow that bitter pill as well. To me, and the only difference being really, Jim Comey didn't have the authority to say and do what he did as the FBI director. Attorney General Barr has the authority to exercise that prosecutorial discretion. The irony, I might as well have been bathing in it today. It was amazing.
Did it smell like sage or I don't know?
It was lavender and vanilla and
liberal tears are replace electrolytes faster than Gatorade.
I mean, Enya was playing in the background, and the essential oils were just flowing.
A little sandalwood.
It's getting weird again.
That's how good it felt.
Yeah. Well, everybody said it was Mueller time. I decided on red wine instead. So
no shame in that.
None. I'm trying to cut down on carbs, so I'm not drinking beer.
You know, Rick, you're doing a fine job here. You're making some dynamite points. I really appreciate all that.
Shut up, Rick. We can't get a word in edgewise, man.
God, man.
God, well, this is Jen and Rick, and I'm talking over Jen and Rick. I'll be
quiet.
There's
a reason we didn't do this under any show banner, because this is how this usually goes. Guys, you got to, for those who don't know, I do this about 13 hours a week? So I don't mind when other people come on and talk. Please continue.
You made me talk for an hour and a half once.
Okay. So everybody else, you complain because they never let you talk. I'm getting thrown under the bus for letting you talk.
Nobody else ever lets me talk, and all of a sudden I'm just talking and talking and talking.
There you go, girlfriend.
I let you talk because
I do a lot of research on the left, so I have a lot of like facts and figures and nonsense in my head that nobody ever wants to hear about because they're too busy arguing on the right, and I just refuse to do that anymore.
Well, hey, let me ask you guys this. What was your network of choice when you were watching the coverage?
I actually watch it live on a YouTube feed because I don't want to hear anybody's commentary.
Okay, well, I was stuck in my office today, so I turned on, you know, whatever channel was available. I work in, like I said, I live in the People's Republic of New York. So
I'm sorry. I fled years ago.
It is what it is, and you know, I got family here. But anyway, I did a lot of channel flipping today. I was going back and forth between a lot of channels and the internet. And I have to say, I expected a meltdown. I did not expect the meltdown that we got.
Oh, baby, it was epic. I mean,
I can just tell you the one thing.
They lost their cookies and kicked them around the field for a while, man. It was amazing.
The one thing that irritated me, because I was on my phone most, I had my phone up and, you know, your phone like puts down the news banners. The thing that irritated me to no end is, as usual, the totally misleading headlines. Trump said the investigation would be the end of his presidency. That's half of what he said. What he said was, this is going to be the end of my presidency. I'm effed. I'll leave the language thing. And then he said,
chicken.
Special counsels take years. I'm not going to be able to get anything done. I mean, there was a whole bunch of commentary after that to explain that point. But the headlines were all like, he's effed because he's guilty of something. That's not at all what he said. It was the most dishonest thing I could possibly think of.
I also really love some of the people that decided to pearl clutch over the fact that he said fucked when when like they use it
really
regularly.
Rashida Tlaib.
Really? I'm like, what are
I'm
you
gonna doing? Impeach the motherfucker. He's really, like, we're gonna faint over that?
But in
I
what
felt bad
world
for BuzzFeed
did you
though
think that Trump would not cuss? Why, like why in what feel... in what world did you think that this person is not someone who uses profanity?
I've never met a CEO who doesn't.
Right. I mean, get real.
I've never met an HR person who doesn't.
I'm the only HR person you know.
No, you're not.
I'm the best one.
Ooh, I didn't think that.
And I'm not an HR person anymore. I had to leave because my function became the fifth column, and I just can't deal with that.
No, I just had to take a shot because
sure,
it was there.
I'm sorry to hear that. I'm sure we're all sorry to hear that. But back on topic for a minute.
Well, that and I got hit by a truck, but that's a completely another Hello. Story. I actually got hit by a truck. It's not a lie.
Not an analogy. No.
Not an analogy. I actually got hit by a truck.
You guys realize I'm resisting the urge of pulling out a business card and handing it to her right now and saying, what happened?
No, that's all taken care of. And you're not on park benches. I know, Eugene.
Okay. Well, listen. In all seriousness, is anybody else impressed by the capacity of the press, especially at like CNN and MSDNC, of
MSDNC?
But their press at speed reading is amazing. I'm an attorney, and I like to think that I can get through documents pretty quickly, especially really dry legal ones.
Right.
But the fact that Laura Jarrett on CNN can read a document that's 400 pages long from the Department of Justice in under 2 minutes and have an opinion on it. I mean, wow.
Well, and I mean, I kind of had to respect because I was flipping back and forth between some of the channels for a little bit because I could. Like, normally I'm in my office and all I've got is computers, so I'm on YouTube or whatever. But I'm like seeing the folks on Fox going, we're still reading, we're still reading, we're still reading, we're going to be reading for days to come. And then I'm going to the other stations and they're like, he's guilty. I mean, it was ridiculous. And
if you know, throughout the day, I did the same as you. I jumped from station to station, channel to channel, and back and forth from the internet. You could literally watch the talking points evolve throughout the day.
Oh, totally.
I mean, Barr was covering something up. Then it was there's obstruction. Then it was the president dropped an F-bomb, and it kept moving up. And every about a half hour, everybody would flip a page, and that topic, whatever they had chosen, would be leading on all of the outlets.
Oh yeah, that literally on my phone, the headlines with Trump. When Trump was informed of special counsel, he said, "This is the end of my presidency." Came from CNN, came from WAPO, came from the New York Times, came from MSNBC, and came from, I think, WAPO and two other stations, like rapid fire in the notifications on my phone. And it was the same freaking words. And I'm
as you pointed out,
I've already read that, and that's a partial quote, and you guys are doing that on purpose, and I want to punch you.
Yeah, I mean, that was obviously, as you pointed out, that's them saying, well, we're going to take the sensational part, and put it out there to stand alone. But we have to, I think we can agree that of all of the stuff in that, in 400 odd pages, that probably was among the more explosive statements that they actually had attributed directly to the president.
Well, yeah, but it wasn't the whole statement.
Well, no, because they're still the media and they're going to spin it whichever way they've been told
to. The appropriate headline would have been, Trump expresses frustration about his legacy upon notification of the special counsel, or something like that. That would have been appropriate, not Trump says it's the end of my presidency when he's notified about Mueller. That's not what he said. He said that, but that was so out of context the way they did it. It was deliberately misleading.
And here's the other thing they did that's deliberately misleading. Go back to the press conference and listen to the description that the Attorney General gives to the different scenarios that were examined that could have been indications of intent to obstruct.
Mm-hmm.
You know how I said it there. It's instances, scenarios, where it's debatable about intent, right?
Mm-hmm.
A couple of hours later, they are now being described as 10 examples of Trump actually obstructing.
Oh, my God.
As a lawyer, that drove me absolutely insane, because it's an abuse of language and words actually do matter. But at the same time, they're going around saying that a fact pattern, which is questionable about one element of obstruction, is now conclusive proof, open and shut, that the entire crime occurred. Is intellectually dishonest, it's misleading, and you have lawyers on those panels going along with it.
Well, of course, because they're going to protect their paychecks, but it's still a matter of that there's an accountability gap there, that they know that they are going to be able to say things like that and get away with it, because there is no universe in which any of them are going to be held to account by anyone of significance. You and I, Stacey, we can sit here and talk about it, and the audience will agree with us primarily. It's possible my mother's listening, and she may not, but we'll let that go.
My mother won't even listen.
But by and large, these people live in this little tiny bubble that they've created for themselves, and they think that's what they hear in there.
But that's the only thing that matters. You have to look at it this way, too. And this is where I think everything's getting completely upside down, right? So if you look at the ratings for Jake Tapper's show this afternoon, he probably got 1 million or less. Okay, that's like how he runs for a State of the Union. He's under 1 million. If I look at your regular podcast for Ben Shapiro, he's got triple that.
Well, sure, but again, their bubble, that's what they know.
But they also took a hit, though, Stacey. CNN and MSDNC mm-hmm. took a hit after the 4-page letter was published in the ratings. There was at one point where the entire primetime lineup was less than what Hannity was bringing in.
You know? Right. Tucker.
Tucker Carlson's had nights where he's beaten all of both networks' lineups combined for the evening.
And this has ramifications for 2020 right now, because that hit is the center left and the independents who lean left leave the bubble. And when they leave the bubble, they're going to be more attuned to crediting the other side that, quote, got it right. Mm-hmm. And they're going to be talking pro-Trump on that side. So this has long-lasting ramifications.
The media numbers were shocking.
We should consider the fact that this is actually a continuing, that this is not actually new. We're noticing it more now because the discrepancy between what we're hearing from the left and the media and what we know to be true has grown so wide that it's hard not to talk about it. But this happened in 2016 as well. They went to the polls on Election Day 2016 and came out absolutely assured that it was going to be Hillary and it was going to be like Reagan in 84 big, that she was just going to bury him alive to the point that after it was over, they began saying this. I mean, that's where the narrative "he didn't win for real" was born. They have yet to accept it. But this, what, and Gene, what
in
you were just
the
saying,
book,
this
in
is
the book,
same
what was her
thing.
Name, Gene?
They're just repeating that same mistake.
What was the girl in the book about the Clinton campaign? I can't remember the title of it right now.
Okay.
It was written about one of the press. It was written by one of the press pool that followed her campaign. Amy.
Oh, the book with the two authors and. Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
The two authors in that book, the two authors wrote that the Russian narrative was born on election night.
Of course.
Yes.
They had to have an explanation that made sense to them.
No, they had to have an explanation that would delegitimize anybody who beat the woman whose turn it was. But I have a question. I have a question for Gene.
I'm here. Go ahead.
Okay. So I've been following a couple of people that I think are not insane. During this whole thing, one of them is Kim Strassel. One of them is Andrew C. McCarthy. And there's been a couple other folks, too. Sarah D. Carter does some good stuff. And Dan Bongino, a lot of people like to paint him as crazy, but I don't think he's as crazy as most people like to say he is. Andrew C. McCarthy has said this. He has actually said in articles and in interviews that he thinks it was an abdication of responsibility for Mueller as a special prosecutor not to make a prosecutorial decision on obstruction, because that's really the only thing he had left to investigate. What do you think about that as far as a special prosecutor's role?
I mean, you sign the retainer first and pay me my never mind.
No, I don't want to know that bad.
Pro bono again, whatever. The answer I can give to that is more about the nature of prosecutors than it is about anything with the law. Mm-hmm. This was Mueller's FU to the big fish he couldn't catch. Mueller didn't want to begrudgingly let the president off the hook, much in the same way that you would see a prosecutor who doesn't have the evidence to get someone on an assault claim or something like that. They don't want that person on the street offending again. So what he did was he planted the seeds that he needed to really put the screws to the person that he thinks did something wrong.
In or some a way, on his team think that.
Well, and people on his team think that. We haven't even gotten to the team, but we can talk about that as well. But this was the way to do the double bird at the president, said, now you got to deal with this. You're not getting away scot-free. That's what that was.
Yeah, but I mean, was it so in a real world district attorney situation, the district attorney has two levers he can pull, yes or no, right? Based on the burden of truth, can you prove, do you have the appropriate evidence to prove that this crime was committed? Can you take this to trial, yes or no? Why does a special prosecutor, or why should a special prosecutor not have to pull one of those levers?
Well, I'd say Barr pulled it for him in that press conference.
No, Barr pulled it for him, but we spent $40 million on this Hoople head. He had thousands of subpoenas, hundreds of interviews, millions of pages of documents. If he couldn't pull the lever, he had to say no.
No. Yeah, it's for the same reason that Jim Comey shouldn't have pulled the lever. It's not his lever to pull. Ben is absolutely right. Just the same way that he said at the press conference, this isn't Mueller's report, this is my report.
Mm-hmm.
The buck stops with the attorney general.
Yeah, he really slammed the door to that too.
There is a chain of command, and that chain of command goes up to the attorney general. He
and
gets
why,
to pull the lever.
Why could he exonerate on collusion?
Well, he didn't exonerate on collusion. He reported that there was no evidence of collusion.
Right.
And Barr concurred. That's the actuality of what happened here. See, there's a political misconception that the Mueller report is an independent counsel.
Okay, so that's the difference. It's the difference between what the law that he functions under and the law that Ken Starr functioned under.
Correct, because there are significant differences between those two laws. If you remember with the Ken Starr report, Jerry Nadler was fighting to keep that report private.
Of course.
Because it was up to Ken Starr to put it out.
Right.
That's not the way it's done anymore. There's supervision from the top echelon of the Department of Justice. It's not an independent counsel. It's a special counsel, which means that they're
still... So the Democrats kind of did this to themselves.
Oh, yeah. You know, much in the same way that Harry Reid is to thank for the nuclear option.
Yeah.
This is, you can thank the Clintons for this as well.
And again, I think it's important to point out that whatever we might think of Mueller, whatever is going to happen to his image in the next few weeks, and I would suggest that he should prepare himself for a good dragging, because the liberal rage mob is not reacting well.
He's getting Comey'd.
But if he had had a path to doing any, to whether it was an obstruction or a collusion, if he had had a path to hang something on the president, he would have done so. And after 2 years coming out and saying, I can't make it work, that is an admission. To me, it seems almost like a surrender. You're saying to the Democrats, I did everything I could, guys. It's not here.
I've done everything I could, guys. It's not here for me from a legal perspective, but here's your path to impeachment. That's what that is.
Yeah, but the impeachment's not going to happen.
Steny Hoyer says it's not going to happen.
Let's talk about it ad nauseum. If you thought that you've heard the last of this, you haven't heard the last of it.
Uh-uh. Of course not. Well, they don't have a plan B, so I can guarantee you this is they bet the whole farm on this. So next 18 months, it's still going to have to be Trump was the bad guy that we say he was, because it's not like they're going to they can't go back his tax returns.
I've heard
it's
this
going to be sorry. It's going to be never ending, because like even look at Schiff and then a bunch of other people kind of parroted this too. You know, he's saying like, the House Intelligence Committee has formally invited Special Counsel Mueller to testify on the counterintelligence. You know, so first it's going to start with, we need him to testify. Then we'll need to follow up with all of his staff. Then we need to see more of the documentation. Then, you know, still won't be okay enough. So now let's interview the many, you know, various people involved. And they're going to basically want to conduct the same investigation all over again in front of the House committee, just to try to keep pushing this as far as it can go, and just to see if they can catch one person in something that they can maybe spend to use to lead up to 2020. I mean, it's not going away.
Do you love the Nadler deadline? Nadler deadline is like right before Horowitz is supposed to release his report, because nobody's saying anything about Horowitz right now. Huh?
Nadler's deadline is based upon his need to get to a cheesecake at Junior's in Brooklyn.
No. It's based on he wants Mueller in front of the Judiciary Committee in the House before the IG report drops.
Gene to correct me if I'm wrong here, because I know that he would have the expertise here. But will the House Intelligence Committee, whether it be Schiff or the ranking Republican, will they receive, for their own perusal, an unredacted version of this report?
I believe the Gang of Eight is getting the report.
All right, so we should assume that this will be leaked sometime in the next 2 weeks.
I think the only thing that stays redacted is the grand jury information, from what I heard today. So they will get all of the intelligence information, ongoing investigations, et cetera, but they will not get the grand jury investigation or the grand jury portions of it, because that is the law.
Well, I will say this then, whatever they do have access to that might be redacted now, not including the grand jury proceedings, given the nature of Adam Schiff, I think you can count on that being leaked sometime in the next couple of weeks. And if it isn't, it'll be because they read it over themselves and realized that they had a big old nothing burger.
Yeah, well, listen, I agree with that, but I don't want to lose the point that Jen made, because she made a really great point. The proof is in the pivot. Look at how the narrative has changed how the goalposts have moved.
Mm-hmm.
We've gone from collusion and conspiracy to obstruction to now you're going to see not a moral leader, unpatriotic, all political buzzwords that in a court of law don't matter, but in the court of public opinion makes Orange Man bad. It's going to turn into a feeding frenzy of political babble. And buckle up, because the next 18 months, it's not going to be collusion delusion anymore. It's going to be the moral saving of the soul of America.
Oh, it's already started. It's already started. I was listening to some news clips on the way home, and they were the Democrats are already starting to say things like, this is unpatriotic, it's un-American, even if it's not criminal, this should have never happened. I even heard
So I'm supposed to believe that the president of the United States, who knew he did not collude with the Russians, was not supposed to be pissed off and a little angry.
You're not supposed to know that he didn't collude with the Russians.
Well, no, but what the special counsel told me.
But they're going to be telling you that he may not be guilty, but he is as far away from innocent as well. That's what they're
whatever. Gonna,
right. What, right. Well, and we've already seen it's like, oh, if you did that because you're mad, it's proof of guilt. People have accused the word proof in this, or it's evidence of this.
Yeah,
like,
because Kavanaugh got mad for being accused of gang rape, so he was unfit for the Supreme Court.
Let me remind everybody real quick that if that's the case and that's their narrative, then they're going to lose because
exactly.
They tried that in 2016. It didn't work. They tried that with Kavanaugh. It didn't work. If they try it again, and I'd say, well, it's like the rest of the stuff they're doing where they have people like Omar and Tlaib running off the cuff, making incredibly bad looking public statements there. And I would refer you back to the bubble that Gene was talking about a moment ago. Inside the bubble, it all sounds good. And let me point out that the bubble has produced nothing but defeats for them. So go to it. I mean, I'm perfectly willing to let them spend the next 16 months retrying this in every court they can find and then watching their sad little faces when Trump takes the second oath of office.
And
I don't see any of their contenders being able to carry that flag to victory.
Well, especially not if they end up. And here's my prediction right now. Well, I'm not going to make a prediction. One of two things is going on. Kamala Harris is just laying back to watch the field and she'll be the eventual nominee. Or because they got rid of superdelegates, they're going to have a contested convention and they're going to be so scared of the Bernie bros staying home, they're going to let it be Sanders.
I don't know.
That man has a solid 25-30% of their base. If that 25-30% of their base stays home, they're screwed.
Well, if they nominate Bernie, they're screwed too.
Since we're reading tea leaves, let me give you some tea leaf reading as well. If we remember the 2016 election. Mm-hmm. What happened on the Republican side when we had a very large field of candidates? You had flavors of the month that would emerge and fall. There would be peaks and valleys for all of them until the money ran dry and one emerged.
Bernie's out-earning them all.
Well, we're going to see what happens with that because each one is going to have their flavor of the month moment. Right now it's Buttigieg who's having his flavor of the month. Before that, it was Francis O'Rourke. And you know, everyone's going to get their little bump. The main difference between what happened in 2016 with Republicans having those peaks and valleys and everyone laughing at ha ha ha, they can't get their act together. Look at all of them on the stage, and you know, you might as well, you know, just point, you know, pick a spinner and point at one of them, and that'll be the nominee. The same thing's going to happen on the left, except the one difference is the other side has a unified message, and that is no Democrat gets by. Trump is the guy. There's a unified message. There's a unified fundraiser. Trump has already run rings around them at the first fundraising period. Mm-hmm. He's going to continue to stack up the money. He's going to continue to have major influence. The economy doesn't seem to be looking to slow down anytime soon. In fact, it's going to be performing better than expected for the first quarter, according to most recent reports. And you're going to see that the strategy that worked for the Republicans in 2016 when it was an open seat is going to implode the Democrats in 2020 when it's a contested incumbent as your challenger.
And there's another key difference there that I want to point it out really quickly. In 2016, you had a Donald Trump. Amidst that crowd, you had a guy whose personality and force of will was powerful enough. And I'm not endorsing or not endorsing. I'm just saying that by sheer force of will, he could dominate the field.
Well, but I've, big,
and
I've
there's
heard
nobody on the Democrat side that has that.
I've well, heard people say
all right, folks,
similar.
I don't mean to cut you off, but we're at the top of the hour. This is going to go on for at least another hour, ladies and gentlemen, for anybody who wants to stay put. We will be right back. This is the special report right here on KLRNradio.com. Collusion delusion came crashing down for the Dems today. We'll be back in about 5 minutes. Stay tuned.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk, or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
Do you need a car? Been shopping only to be turned down because of bad credit, low credit, no credit, bankruptcy, or divorce? Guess what? Today's your lucky day, because now you can buy a car, truck, or SUV, just about any vehicle. It's true. Bad credit? Doesn't matter. No credit? Doesn't matter. Bankruptcy or divorce, it just doesn't matter. As a matter of fact, your job is your ticket to your new vehicle. We're Auto Credit Express, and we've helped thousands of people just like you. Antonio H. told us, great company, got me connected, and the day I went in, I drove off in the car I wanted. 100% worth your time. Need a car? Get started now and drive off as early as today. Just text FINANCE, FINANCE, to 357-911 right now to get started. That's FINANCE, FINANCE, to 357-911. Auto financing the easy way. Text FINANCE to 357-911.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Everyone loves liberty. Our rights come from God, not the government. So why are you letting other people tell you what's best for your health care? Exercise your freedom with Liberty HealthShare. Liberty HealthShare is a community of people who voluntarily share one another's medical costs. Liberty HealthShare is founded on the idea that most people truly want to help one another. Healthcare sharing allows members to do just that as a true community that supports one another in times of need. Liberty believes people should make decisions for themselves and their families. Members are able to take back the freedom to make their own decisions about their health care. Freedom from guilt or doubt about how your money is used. You have the freedom to direct your health care, not to be dictated to by bureaucrats. Stop letting others tell you what to do and join a community of like-minded people. Exercise your freedom. Join Liberty HealthShare and take back the control of your health care while helping those around you. Call Liberty at 855-58-LIBERTY. Again, that's 855-58-LIBERTY for more information, or you can check them out at libertyhealthshare.org. Again, that's libertyhealthshare.org.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq. Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
At St. Jude, a family never sees a bill at all. It's like the world has been lifted off of your shoulders.
St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, finding cures, saving children. Learn more at stjude.org.
Sometimes riders feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our riding into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable riders to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
My head, I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh,
all right, folks, welcome back to the program. This is a special edition here on KLRN Radio. We've been talking the Mueller report, the Mueller drop, the libs' heads exploding, the tweet storm, all of the above. Before we get on to the rest of the show, because actually I do want to get into some of the stuff Jane had mentioned about wanting to talk about the rest of the Mueller team a bit, but I have something I want you guys to hear first. I'm working on making sure it actually plays the audio.
No!
Alright, so it was from YouTube. I wasn't sure. Sometimes some of the stuff on Twitter doesn't play right away. Alright, so you guys will recognize this person in a moment. He is our favorite liberal prognosticator. You know him as Larry the Liberal. Here is his take to the Mueller report dropping today. And let's just say it's a little stressful.
No! 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 I'm sitting here watching the lies on TV. This E.G. Barr is saying Trump had nothing to do with it, that he's not guilty. Nobody believes that. Nobody believes that. He's guilty. He colluded with Russia. They've been saying it on MSNBC and CNN for 2 years now. I've listened to them for 2 years. They've put it in my head that he's guilty. And now Fox, I'm watching Fox here because that's all I get. And then they're saying he's innocent. He's not innocent. Nobody with that color hair is innocent. God! I don't know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna. If this is true, it can't be true. It can't be true. He's guilty as. The four members there, and he's indicated
that he is willing to. I don't know. To me, that pretty much summed up the media reaction pretty well as well.
I mean. I kind of feel sorry for a lot of liberals out there. I mean, am I the only one that has a little sympathy for them?
No, I mean, I actually think people who've been watching Rachel Maddow for the last two years should probably sue her. They thought the world was ending.
Okay, can we talk? Since you brought up Rachel Maddow. How is she not considered the Alex Jones of the left at this point?
Because the left has never been very good at drawing the line between what's acceptable and what's unacceptable. On the right, we all kind of know Alex Jones is off the ranch. we don't bother him and we don't bother his followers, but nobody serious takes him seriously. The left doesn't do that because of their inclusivity.
But at the same time, how does this not register when if I hear the name Konstantin Kilimnik one more time, I might have to punch someone.
Okay, let's just look at it this way.
No. See, it doesn't count when you just say it like that.
Well, but let's look at it this way. Al Sharpton, the biggest race insider, race baiter, freaking piece of crap person in the world, has a show on MSNBC. Do you really think MSNBC is like the vanguard of anything?
Well, no, I don't think that they're the vanguard of anything, but you gotta see, this is where I feel for the people who watch the show. They've been hoodwinked, bamboozled, run amok, yep, and all that and more. And like the battered wives and husbands of the world, they keep going back.
Well, no, I mean, her viewership dropped dramatically after the report did.
But there's still those out there that keep going back for more.
Yeah, I know. They're all over my Twitter feed.
And there's a good reason to stay away from Twitter for a while, because yeah. I got to think, and you're an expert on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
How describe the mood for those people who may not be on Twitter as often. Like, describe the mood. What is the pulse of Twitter right now? How chaotic is it?
Because I'm a moderate sized conservative account. You know, I go through my news app and I see my politicians like Adam Schiff that I have to make fun of. So the only time I really have a lot of liberals jumping in is if I'm mocking a Democrat. Other than that, most of my interactions are with other sane people. So, I mean, like the journalist Twitter, you know, like, hi, I'm Jim Acosta. I love me some Jim Acosta. It is pretty sad. I mean, they're really grasping at straws, and I guess their followers are grasping at the same straws because they want so badly for some of this to go on. But for me, it's mostly like, no. And I mean, I just ask simple questions. Okay, give me some concrete evidence of. I don't care about your feelings. I don't care how you feel. I don't care how much you don't like this man. That's not the point. Give me something concrete, and they can't, and then they don't respond to me and they run away because I've already said I don't care how you feel.
You know, that's what?
Not important to me. Huh?
I don't even need that much. I just need reason. How about a little bit of critical thinking is all I would really need. I feel like that's missing from the coverage at this point because everyone is so busy being shocked and offended by the president, and how could he say this, and how could he have done this, and if this is true, you know, all this cognitive dissonance going on, I just want reason at this point. You can have an opinion about that disagrees with me, but and that's cool. I love hearing.
That's fine.
Give me something with some sort of stable foundation under it, though.
I mean, here's my thing, and I think this goes to a lot of people who felt like I did in 2016, and just at the end is like, I can't vote for either one of these people. They're just both insane, right? She's a criminal. He's nuts. You know, it comes down to me, I guess, at this point, is there are certain things. He wasn't the disaster we all thought he was going to be, so I will most likely, unless something terrible happens, pull the lever for him in 2020. But everything about Donald Trump, he was the CEO of a business. We saw him on The Apprentice. He is a brash Manhattan businessman, billionaire, worked in construction. And you know what the construction industry is like in New York. I know what it's like in Chicago. I mean, come on.
Was that
like the whole idea that he gets ticked off and use bad language and might try to bully some people, that's all baked into the calculus at this point. I really don't care.
Yeah, I will neither confirm nor deny I know anything about the construction industry in New York. But anyway,
But yeah, I get it. I mean, the reason why I voted for Donald Trump is because the Supreme Court was my one issue. I was a one issue voter on preserving not only the balance of the court, but also the strict constructionalists throughout the court system. And this was a very pivotal year. And luckily, my vote has been rewarded many times over, thanks to Mitch McConnell and Team Mitch, which may be the greatest presence
cocaine Mitch
since Wendy's. The greatest presence on the internet since Wendy's. And I'm you know, that faith rewarded there for me on that. But at this point, the credibility gap is so far apart that it's scary. Everything that Trump has said, forget about how he says it, just about everything the man has said, he's been right on. Now, you can say that Sarah Sanders has been inaccurate or has said false stories or Sean Spicer did that or whatever. I'm talking about the man himself. When something comes out of his mouth, no matter how outlandish it is, he's been right. I was phone tapped. Turns out he was spied on. We can go through a whole litany of different things. But, you know, the economy is going to turn around. I'm going to bring back manufacturing jobs. He's been dead on more often than not, yet he's still seen as dumb, even though he's been right. And I just don't get that credibility gap, because then the other side is flowery speaking and uses $5 words and is highfalutin and hoity-toity, as they say, around my neck of the woods. And every other word is a lie. It's just inaccurate, or it has to do more with, like you said, more with feelings than it does with fact. The credibility gap is a wide one to breach for any 2020 candidate going forward.
Well, and my whole thing is, I've watched what's gone on in the border. The mess there right now is 100% the Democrats' fault. 100%, without a doubt. Trump said we need housing. He didn't focus on a wall. He focused on housing. He focused on more immigration judges. He focused on technology, and he focused on physical barriers. We need all four of those things. And he took Customs and Border Patrol's recommendations seriously, and that's what he asked for. And the Democrats turned them down, and they gave us the MS-13 protection bill. So I'm a little bit of an – I'm not even an immigration hawk. I just truly believe – that immigration should be in our national interest, and nothing about our immigration system is set up that way right now. Like, if you could give us Canada's immigration system, you know how everybody loves Justin Trudeau, thinks he's freaking awesome on the left?
Okay, I mean, he's
freaking. Give me Justin Trudeau's immigration system. Do that. It's skills-based. There is no chain migration. Refugees are limited, the whole nine yards. If you give me Canada's immigration law, if you think Trudeau is great and Canada's an awesome place, let's just take their immigration law. Will you pass it? That would be great. So I am 100% with the Trump administration on the border at this point, and watching the judicial activism makes my blood pressure want to just go through the roof. This last injunction just about sent me over the edge. As far as all that goes, and I would be 100% fine if President Trump defied it. It's garbage. I mean, Barack Obama did it all the time. Trump's never done it, no matter how ridiculous it is. So this one was ridiculous. Just go ahead and do it, Donald. Just go ahead and do it. So that's one of my, like, you can't even take a legitimate crisis seriously. That's a problem.
You know, Rick, I've learned over the years that when Stacey gets on a rant, you just let it go till it runs out. No. Stacey equals ratings. What are you talking about? Sorry. No, don't do that. I'm going to get serious about that. Why don't you just let you go? I mean,
it's like he doesn't have to even be smart. He's just right.
He and that's what I'm saying about the credibility gap right now. When have the Democrats been right on an issue? When has the Democrats taken a position on an issue? How about that?
My favorite was actually Leslie Stahl on 60 Minutes this weekend. Okay, you've been in 100 days, Nancy. What have you done? She almost tripped over herself because they haven't done anything except pass resolutions. and the resolutions they pass can't even condemn anti-Semites in their own party. It's garbage.
Well, you know what? I actually just thought of a position they took. Mm. They took a position that you could kill a baby after it's born.
That's true.
They right. took a position. That's one of their main policy points that they took a position on. They took a yep. position on on getting rid of air travel. That's one of their they yeah. took up. They took a position that everyone should stop eating meat because cow farts are endangering the welfare of the earth. That's a position they took. So yeah,
I'm not voting for anything where I can't have ice cream. That's wrong.
Well, you can have ice cream. It's just Ben and Jerry's ice cream. That's the only ice cream you can have.
No, if you don't have cows, you can't have any ice cream.
I mean,
Ben and Jerry's is over.
I mean, they're gonna find goat technology or something like that.
They're gonna make. They're gonna spend a lot of time creating non-farting cows.
You can't
make a cow not fart. It has five stomachs.
Listen, no, they're going to figure it out. They're going to throw a lot of money away trying to make that happen so that they can save from
John F. We've gone from John F. Kennedy saying we will put a man on the moon to Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez saying we will stop cow from farting.
Did you all see that video?
Oh, her latest one?
Did you see that video? Do you even understand what that video says? That video says that you could look from one end of this country to the other and you will never find a yellow lab that loves you as much as that girl loves herself.
Probably right.
That was the most arrogant, sophomoric pile of bullshit I have ever seen.
And we all have Joe Crowley to thank for this, because if it wasn't for Joe Crowley here in the People's Republic of New York City, taking his district for granted, not recognizing the changing demographics of his district, you would never have had an Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. And by the way, you know, this may be a little too much tea leaf reading. You may not see Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez stay in Congress as long as you think she's going to.
Dean, do not excite me like that.
Well, I want to put a tingle up your leg right now, because
I think I am Chris Matthews.
Here's my AOC theory. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez will most likely win re-election in 2020. I made it complete only because she's from the People's Republic of New York, and there will be a massive backlash against the president in heavily Democratic districts. As Nancy Pelosi says, a glass of water with the Democratic Party label can win in that district.
Mm-hmm.
No doubt about it.
But why can't it just be a different Democrat?
Well, it could possibly, but here is where it gets interesting. You may not want to put anybody against her now because she's digging a hole for herself, but what happens after the 2020 election? Redistricting.
Yay! I think Andy will take her out.
New York is losing population. On average, there's a study that came out recently that on average, every day, the People's Republic of New York City loses 108 people and New York State loses 133 people. Uh-huh. Just came out, you know, I think it came out today. It was definitely this week.
That was ahead of the curve.
That means New York will lose congressional seats. What happens typically when you do congressional redistricting? Last one in, first one out. Who's the last one in? Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. She will have no district to run in. They'll gerrymander her into another district with a well-established, well-heeled incumbent.
Mm-hmm.
There'll be a war to end all wars, and she'll eventually end up losing to the Democratic machine that now sees her coming.
Okay. That's well, not only that, like, I've written a couple articles, Gene, and you might like them, talking about Sherry Bustos and the DCCC and the New Democrat Coalition. Sherry Bustos basically put the kibosh on future, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez's. She may be the last of her breed.
One could only hope, of course.
Well, what they have said is they will no longer, the Democrat Congressional Campaign Committee will no longer work with contractors who work on campaigns for people who primary incumbent Democrats. So you can take Sherry Bustos and her 200 plus houses that have to run, or 200 plus seats that have to run for reelection, or you can take this dipshit that's gonna run against Henry Cuellar down in Texas, down in Texas, and that'll be the only job you get this election cycle.
And that's a definite big deal. It's also representative of the schism that exists in today's Democratic Party. I mean,
I wrote all about that.
There you go. And I'm
you know, the funniest part of this schism for me, and I have to tell this story because it cracks me up. So Sherry Bustos from Illinois 17, runs for head of the DCCC. The Congressional Black Caucus comes to her and says, you got to stop these insurgent primaries. We had two members that had really bloody campaigns. They won, but man, they wasted a lot of money. Bustos says, I got it, right? So she kneecaps the insurgent campaigns. The Progressive Caucus, which has all seven Justice Democrats in it, starts bitching and moaning and complaining and going to the media and this, that, and the other thing. And Bustos stays strong. Do you know the two members of the Black Caucus that got primaried are also in the Progressive Caucus?
It's like a circular firing squad, isn't it?
It's a complete circular firing squad. Well, and Nancy Pelosi can't even say the same thing in two successive interviews. It's actually really funny to watch.
Oh, it's hilarious to watch, but you're going to see it play out in 2020, because all these candidates now, you know, all 758 of them are going to have to make a choice. They're going to have to say, am I going to play to my base and try to be popular, or am I going to try to play it cool for the money? That's the eternal struggle for candidates now.
Part of what I said before, that the left has never been very good at saying, no, that's outside of what's acceptable. Like, no, America's a capitalist society. Socialists don't get to caucus with us, and socialists can't run for our nomination. Like, that would have been great, because back in 1988, when Jesse Jackson was running, Michael Harrington, who was head and co-founder of the DSA, he happened to be dying of cancer at the time, but he said, we can't create our own party. We have to transform a current party, and I choose the Democrats. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, and he said, we need a crisis, most likely a financial crisis, and he predicted one on the scale of the Great Depression following Reagan. Never happened. So now they've created this crisis 12 years out, and they're kind of trying to run on that. But the media and everyone else is propping up these little socialist darlings, right? And Nancy Pelosi has completely lost control of her caucus. So this has been a long-term strategy by the far left. They've finally infiltrated. The Democrats, mostly Sherry Bustos, are trying to kneecap them at the helm and keep them out of the party. And all of her folks come from the New Democrat Coalition, which is very business friendly, though very socially liberal, up to including killing babies full term. But they're not socialists, so they can come off economically as moderates. Those are the people that are recruiting all of the candidates this year. And they flipped 17 seats last cycle. So
I hear
you. And now they're eyeballing Texas. So everyone should be on alert.
Oh, yes. The great white whale, Texas. Here we go again.
No, they did it in Orange County. Those are all their candidates.
I think that Texas will be okay on a national level. One thing I noticed, especially here in the People's Republic of New York, there are certain populations in certain districts that will flip-flop between state and federal. Mm-hmm. You'll see districts that are voting for, you know, the most liberal of liberals on the state level that will vote for Donald Trump on the federal level.
Right, and but what I'm saying is they're targeting six House races. Do we need six more blue seats in Congress? No, we don't.
I hear you, but I think unless there's been a really rapid population shift in those areas that they think they're going to win on, they're not going to be able to concentrate the resources.
Austin, Houston, Dallas. Jen?
Okay, Austin. Yeah, I see that. I just see that there are so many seats that they're going to have to defend, like New York 11, for instance, that, you know, they should win, but they always have trouble winning. And, you know, it might be a little too soon to tell. I would want to see fundraising. I want to see the actual candidates themselves, not just an abstract of them. But I hear you on that.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I would disagree with you with in what you said is about Nancy Pelosi. I can't stand her. Can't stand her at all. But the reason why she's had such staying power is because she has always controlled the donor base of the Democrats. The road to 2020 runs through Nancy Pelosi. If you don't get the money from her, you are going to have a hard time getting it from the Linda Sarsours of the world or the Black Lives Matters of the world.
Or and the Justice Democrats.
Or the Twitter blogosphere on the left. They are not the majority of the party. They may be the loudest in the party, but they're not the majority of the party. And you're going to need, and I'm not exaggerating, you're going to need $1 billion to be able to take on President Trump. Not only do you have to get by the war chest he's going to have, which he can get to $1 billion, but you're going to have to get by the name recognition that he has and the visibility that he has when he's doing presidential things on the campaign trail. It's going to take $1 billion. You're not going to get that without Nancy Pelosi's blessing.
Speaking
that,
of that, hang on, just 1 second. Speaking of President Trump, there's something that the media is not really talking about. He has outraised everybody so far in the first fundraising sector. Mm-hmm. I believe last count was somewhere around, what was it, 30 something million. And the average donation was roughly $34. So you're talking about a lot of people.
The DCC and so that the House committees, the Democrats and the Republicans are only $1 million apart.
Yeah, well,
right. That's the one thing that's not being reported is the RNC fundraising is just as strong as the Trump fundraising.
Right.
In actuality, when you look at that $30 million number, it's more like closer to 60 to 100 million when you're talking about political capital because of the access to money with the RNC and other PACs as well. There is a ton of money early on for Trump right now, more so than any incumbent going into a second term election. And that's not an exaggeration. That's actually documented fact right now.
Average $34 too.
Which means that there is a very wide donor base
that's
happening to once.
I just want to see I see this whole thing on the left, right? Where Bernie is the Trump of the Democratic Party and the Kamala Harris's and Beto O'Rourke's and Pete Buttigieg and Elizabeth Warren's of the world are all mirroring his policies, but they're going to try to be shooting each other. His like little 25% of the party has been so solid for so long, and the Democrats know that they're the reason that Hillary lost in 2016. I think they're going to have a really hard time bridging the gap between the Bernie bros and somebody who's more along the lines of Joe Biden, who probably should be their nominee.
Okay, can I play something for you real quick to let you hear something?
What do you think? This is your show?
Really, Rick?
Well, I want you to hear something because I don't think the media wants Bernie. This is a couple minutes long, but
no, they don't.
I want you guys to hear it.
Absolutely.
Because you know this whole thing about fair share.
Oh yeah.
Okay. So he was asked about now he's a millionaire and his fair share. And let me play the exchange.
Your marginal tax rate was 26% because of President Trump's tax cuts. So why not say, you know, I'm leading this revolution. I'm not going to take those.
Come on, but dearie, I pay the taxes that I owe. And by the way, why don't you got Donald Trump up here and ask him how much he pays in taxes?
Okay, the other guy's doing it, so I'm doing it too, is not a good answer. Okay, I think we all can agree that was not a good
answer. Now, for the record, this exchange right here is CNN.
Ready for that. And by the way, I don't know how a millionaire is paying 26%. He's got a good accountant. What do you make of this response?
Well, first of all, I was shocked that he actually combed his hair, which was great. That's a great start for a millionaire.
Okay, that was unnecessary.
No, look, here's what he needs to do, and that what they need to do at the University of Vermont. They need to teach a course, and Bernie can be Professor Bernie again, and talk about the virtues of the free market versus socialism, which he espouses, which has collapsed everywhere. Socialism destroys wealth.
That's
it destroys
CNN.
Freedoms. Here
well,
he made,
yes,
as Jeff
is.
Said, as a perfect example. He worked hard. I don't envy Bernie Sanders. I'm proud. I'm happy for him that he made $2 million on a book sale. But here's what I would suggest with that $2 million. Here's what he should do. Because in Vermont, they pay the highest monthly premiums for health insurance. He wants to give away free health insurance. He could buy the free health insurance for 350 people in Vermont with that $2 million.
So that's the thing, because he scoffs, I pay the taxes I owe. By the way, that's the rule.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is when you're Bernie Sanders and you rail against people paying their fair share and you don't have the huge charitable donations and you're not donating money to the IRS, you are a hypocrite.
There's no inherent hypocrisy in saying, I would prefer a socialist system. We live in this one, and I pay the taxes I owe. There's no inherent hypocrisy in that. But when he spent the weekend attacking a liberal outlet for correctly citing that he has changed in his speeches, railing against millionaires and billionaires, to railing against multimillionaires and billionaires, the defensiveness just shows it really undermines the integrity of his message, and the integrity of his message was what Bernie Sanders had.
CNN has just basically...
Yeah, but did you miss the one in the New York Times?
Yeah, but I mean, as this goes on and he becomes less popular because it's going to happen...
It's because his base is not the people that are watching CNN. They're watching Sankungar on the Young Turks. Sorry.
Guys,
and Sank has a bigger viewership.
Yeah. Well.
Hang on a second. I just want to make an observation. I want to see what you guys think of it. Bernie Sanders is getting the Ron Paul treatment.
Yep.
Pretty much.
What's happening now is that Ron Paul struck a nerve with arch conservatives in 2009, 2010, 2011, running up to 2012, which ran then moderated. But it was the same effect that Stacey's been talking about this whole time. Ron Paul would have a massive army of young people behind him. He wouldn't make any hay while the sun was shining. He'd eventually drop out. And what happened when he dropped out? A vacuum of not only people, but a vacuum of energy was lost overall in the process. It's the same thing with Bernie Sanders.
But Bernie's not going to drop out. Number one. I think Bernie will be in it. Bernie will be in it till the convention.
Oh, it wouldn't make sense for him to drop out. And I'm talking dollars and cents.
No. Bernie will be in it until the convention. I think the difference between him and Rand Paul is he has some substantial progressive outlets behind him, and he has some very digitally savvy organizers. So if you look at the Sean McElways, if you look at the Justice Democrats, if you look at what's his name? I can't remember. Zach Exley, right? So the Bernie bros that were with his campaign have all blossomed into their own much larger organizations now. And those are all going to be behind Bernie. And like I said, there's not as many people watching that segment on CNN as there are kids watching Sank on the Young Turks.
But here's where I think the mood changes for Bernie. Mm-hmm. And I agree with everything you said. It's no longer a 50-50 choice. It's no longer the Hillary wing versus the Bernie wing.
They also lost superdelegates.
There are so many factions.
They're all the same.
That no, they're really not all the same because they all come in different flavors. There's going to be different lanes, much like there were different lanes when we had the primary.
Yeah, but you had Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz running down the same lane. They ended up fighting each other instead of fighting Donald Trump. You're going to see the same thing in the Democratic Party.
You had the social conservative lane. You had the libertarian lane. You had the Trump lane. What you ended up having here, you're going to have so many segments because the left is so segmented. You're going to have the women's lane, the people of color lane, the people of color women's lane, and it's going to keep going on and on and on. The LGBT lane, now you have Buttigieg in. I mean, and all of them.
I honestly don't see it. I don't see it as that clean cut. I mean, you've got the intersectionalism there, but the person has to have overall intersectional cred. Buttigieg doesn't have it. He's a white gay male. The fact that he's a white male overshadows his gayness. I mean, literally, if you look at the hierarchy, that's just the truth. But the only person with true intersectional cred in the whole race right now is Kamala Harris, and she's polling at 7%.
But you're missing the point of the other lane he has. He has a white lane as well. It could be because he has
the educated whites in the Democrat Party don't want to vote for a white dude.
They may not say that they do. But why does Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders going to lead the fundraising numbers?
Because I believe with Joe Biden, he's seen as less of an extremist, and not all of these policies, Medicare for All, Green New Deal, are as popular with the mainline Democrat Party as people would like to admit. New York Times just did a huge spread. The people that are active online are a very small portion of the Democratic base, and they tend to be the most radical. Most Democrats don't spend time online. They're a lot more centrist. They're less educated than the people spending time online, and they're going to gravitate towards somebody more like Joe Biden who doesn't sound crazy to them. So that's actually the New York Times's theory, and the New York Times doesn't want people to vote for Joe Biden. The New York Times doesn't really want people to vote for Bernie Sanders. But the Democrat Party, in terms of controlling who their nominee is, took all of their power away when they took away the superdelegates. They are going to be in no different a position in 2020 than the Republican National Committee was in 2016. And somebody is going to win that nomination, not with a majority, but with a plurality.
I'm not so sure, because coalitions will coalesce. I think eventually you'll see like the women of color lane and the women lane will come together. I think you'll see the old white guys and the young white guys will come together once the Swalwells and the Buttigieg's have their moment. And, you know, then they'll merge into the Beto lane, and the Beto lane will merge with the Biden lane. And I think that there is a way to get to that majority. And I think in a way there has to be, because in a race with so many candidates, the money is where it's at. The money will dictate who the nominee will be. And who controls the money? The old white limousine liberals. They're going to be the ones to end up getting that majority. Also, for appearances purposes, while I like to think that there'll be a plurality there, there is no way that there's going to be a contested convention for optics. The optics of it all dictates that you get a single nominee on the first ballot.
I don't know, because the big consultant that just met with 100 donors said the likelihood, based on the 2020 rules, that it's going to be a contested convention is significant.
They said the same thing about the 2016 Republican convention, and it didn't happen because the optics demands unity.
They've got this serious problem with a socialist base, because they never excised it and they abandoned the working class, right? They have a serious problem with that activist base just going, really, screw you, we're out of here, if they don't think they're going to get a fair hearing.
They're counting on the fear of Trump overwhelming the fear of let me say this another way. They are waiting for the fear of Trump to beat the couch. They don't have to get behind a great candidate. They just have to be more motivated than a Trump reelection. That's what they're counting on. It's more about beating the couch at this stage of the game than anything else. I agree with you. All things equal, and in a very clinical sense, that is what logically should happen. But the one thing I've learned about institutional politics is that there is nothing logical happening because the thumb is always on the scale. And the thumb will be on the scale by the donors for who they want. Because as you said, these people that are online and that are vocal and that are activists, they have nowhere else to go. They can't go to Trump. It's an anathema for them to go to Trump. They have nowhere else to go except the couch. They just have to beat the couch, and they think they're going to beat Trump.
Can I jump in real quick and just say that I've really enjoyed this discussion, but I do have to hop off. Thanks.
I know. I'm with you, Jen. I'm with you.
So thanks, y'all, for having me, but I got to run.
Night, Jen.
Aww, we miss you.
Okay, thanks. I'll talk to y'all later.
Bye.
Bye.
All right, so anything else you guys want to touch on? We've got about 14 minutes till we're back around the top of hour two.
Yeah,
I don't know. I think I could just take a nap.
You know, Stacy.
What?
I want to know where we can find all your articles online right now. Where's the best place to go?
Actually, I post all my articles on a Facebook page called Stacy Lennox or at the Liberty Gypsy. And that's where I post all of my content together. And I will actually answer questions about it because some of the stuff I do pretty heavy research on. And I try to write it up as clearly as possible, but people still have some questions. So.
Ooh. And Rick, if people want to find out more about what you're doing, because you have a ton of shows and I don't know how you do it all, where are we going to find all that?
The majority of my content can actually be found right here on the stream everybody's listening to. I'm a programming director and president, KLRNradio.com Incorporated. And also coming soon-ish, I have a weekend gig starting on KOKC 95.3 FM 1520 AM. Start date still to be determined. So as soon as that actually gets up and running, I'll definitely put that out everywhere. Easiest way to keep up with everything we're doing is either to follow along with the station, either on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. Mine's at KLR and Radio, or you can follow along with me at RowdyRick73 on Twitter and Instagram, and also just Rick Robinson on Facebook.
And by the way, I know that Rick is a little too modest to mention this, but he does accept donations in the form of liquor. So if there is any unwanted bottle that you have, and it could be the low end stuff, guys. By the way, it doesn't have to be the high end stuff. It's got some.
No, yeah, I only take high end stuff.
I do have some standards. I mean, I would prefer the high end stuff, but yeah, I mean, beggars can't be choosers either. So,
I'm just trying here. Jeez, Louise. But okay. And as for me and plugs, I'm just a burned out former radio guy that's trying to make his way in the world. So, yeah.
You ought to come back, Gene.
No, you know what?
What happened to your partner? Where's Ross?
Russ is doing great. Russell Gallo, my former partner on my radio show, is getting married in September.
No.
His longtime fiance. And I am so thrilled about it, by the way. And that's happening in September. So he's doing great, thank God. Contrary to the predictions that we're all
contrary making. To internet rumors and things we would have assumed if you met him at CPAC.
Oh, Lord. Anyway, I shall neither confirm nor deny any of those rumors. But
I've been to an unsustainable bar tab party or two.
Yeah, they're kind of the stuff of legends now, from what I understand. But anyway.
We seem to be able to make them happen anytime, like, one or three of us is there. We're not sure why, but.
Indeed. All right. So, what's the final takeaway from today? For me, I guess the final takeaway is that we've hit the end of the beginning, not the beginning of the end.
Uh-huh.
To be an issue that's going, you know, the Mueller investigation and we pivoting from, you know, collusion to obstruction is the new dominant issue of 2019 for the Democrats.
Absolutely.
We haven't talked much about the Republicans and what they're going to do, mainly because if they're that dumb that they can't figure out what to do, then they really don't belong in office at this point. They just have to stay the course. Everything is coming to them. They don't have to go to anything. They need to just keep the course, talking about issues, talking about immigration, talking about national security, talking about the economy, making sure that the economy stewardship is very well handled, making sure that job numbers are good, the stock market keeps going up, the Fed doesn't get screwed up with a new appointment of a Fed chairman, and 2019 should be a coast for them, where they can just fundraise and build up their money while the Democrats are slashing and burning their entire party. That's kind of the takeaway for me of this whole thing. It's so, remember the Geico commercials? It was so easy, even a caveman can do it. Well, this should be so easy that Paul Ryan could do it. And I'm just,
except he's not there anymore.
Well, but that's what I'm saying. If you remember Paul Ryan and the number of things that were screwed up with him when we had a majority and we couldn't get things passed, this is so easy that even someone like him couldn't screw it up. So easy, Boehner could do it. How about that? Is that a better?
Oh, God. Well, I mean, I agree with you. This is not the beginning of the end. It's the end of the beginning. I think it will be interesting to see. To my mind, the Republicans have a strategy. They keep doing what they're doing. Focus on the economy. Focus on jobs. Focus on immigration. Keep highlighting Democrat failures there. I mean, there's no different messaging from them right now. Keep confirming judges, you know, keep going, McConnell, keep going, remake the judiciary. We need it. Right. So I don't see their path changing other than too much saying, you think he did what? You're insane. Right. The Democrats have a couple of different paths they can take, both on the Mueller report and internally. So their strategic decision making is actually, I think, a lot more difficult to navigate at this point. You know, they've already gotten the question, you've been in for 100 days. What have you accomplished? The answer is nothing. So, and not only that, going into 2020, you know, what Ronna McDaniel and the Republicans need to be focused on is holding these new quote unquote moderate Democrats like Katie Hill in California accountable to being actually moderate. They're not. They need to be hitting those flip seats really freaking hard and making these people go on record in ways that are really uncomfortable so that they start getting splits on the vote on MTRs more frequently and really start showing the cracks in that entire caucus, because it wouldn't be that hard to do.
All right. Sounds good to me. Rick, you got a last thought for us about this whole night here? It's a very big night, by the way.
For me, I think the biggest thing, I mean, honestly, like I said, I unfortunately have a day job, so I've been kind of doing the hot takes all day when I could on breaks and everything else. So for me, I think the biggest takeaway I have is, I just like you, I don't think this is anywhere near over yet. I don't think the left's ready to let it go. And unfortunately, even though I don't think there's no there, I think you were right. I think Mueller found a way to give Trump the double bird on the way out the door and say, now you've got to deal with this, and it's going to be just enough to keep the Dems in the fight. But I don't know if it's going to be enough at this point, because here's the thing. Those of us that live this, that are political animals, we're reading it all the time, we're talking about it all the time, pretty much, I mean, it drives my wife crazy. She leaves the room if I turn on news stations, because she's like, this is all you ever do, I'm going to go watch something else. It drives her crazy. But the thing about that is, that's everybody else. They've been hearing about this for 2 years. It doesn't impact their everyday regular life, and they don't care anymore. in the bubble, all of this sounds really good, but Nancy and Joe Q Public, they don't care. They're done. The report's already been out. He's pretty much been exonerated. Most everyday average Americans know that there's not really anything that's going to happen because, yes.
No collusion, no obstruction. Good.
And that's basically where we are. So, yeah, I mean, Congress may get this wild hair and the House may decide, we're going to impeach him because Mueller said he couldn't prove that there was no collusion. But what good does that do? They're not going to convince the Senate Republicans to jump ship. There's no way at this point, with as crazy as they're... I mean, let's look at this from another perspective. They've had control of the House for how many days now? They can't even get their own side to put a budget together. Because they're too focused on this. If they can't start putting things together, then this momentum they thought they built is going to fall apart. Because they're not doing anything.
Absolutely right. I'm with you 100% on it. On everything you've said. And I guess the only thing that we should say to our listeners is don't take our word for it. We're just a bunch of people hanging out basically on the virtual stoop, as it were, just shooting the you know what, talking politics. But don't take our word for it. Don't take our hot take for it. In fact, don't take anybody's hot take for it. You have primary source material available to you if you are so inclined. There's 400 pages out there that you can delve into, that you can do a control find and find out just about anything you want to find out about. What was that whole thing about Papadopoulos about? How do you even spell Papadopoulos? What's all this nonsense about Manafort? Who is Carter Page? Why should I care? Anything that we brought up here, obviously I'm talking to a lot of the people who are the wonks in the world that like this kind of stuff and that seek out this content. Go out there and get your hands dirty into the information itself. Don't just trust our takes on it. You need to be engaged because you know that the other side is going to be engaged. And other than that, guys, I only have one other topic to bring up, if you don't mind.
Go right ahead, sir. The floor is yours.
I don't know if we know this, but we are now one step closer to the zombie apocalypse. Have you seen the latest breakthroughs in science?
No. Apparently, the brain thing. Yeah,
apparently,
no.
Apparently, scientists in their inimitable wisdom have been able to reanimate the brains of, I think, 32 pigs that had been slaughtered and killed for some hours, and they ended up being animated. Now, I don't know about you, but I draw the line at zombie pigs, okay? I'm all about beating death and, you know, seeing if we can reach immortality and pushing the bounds of science. But if that means pig zombies, I don't know how I feel about that.
Though yeah, I'm all against pig zombies.
But I think they could be used in the battle against Middle East terrorism. So there could be a silver lining to that as well. We'll have to see.
I only have one question. Does pig zombie bacon taste as good as regular pig bacon? # asking for a friend.
I don't think you would want it. I mean, I've seen The Walking Dead.
Probably not. I read an interesting article. I don't remember where it was. But there was an article I read not too long ago that they basically said that with all of the advancements in medicine, that the longer we prolong life, the more likely we are to become zombies. Because the one thing we haven't been able to figure out how to do is make sure that we don't lose brain cells so we can keep the rest of our body alive for an extended period. But eventually the brain cells are going to die. So I think we may be two steps closer to the zombie apocalypse.
Well, that's something to look forward to. Thanks a lot, Rick. I appreciate that.
You're welcome. Just, you know, wanted to give you something to think about as you were trying to nod off to sleep tonight. All right, so we've got about 2 minutes left. Any last thoughts?
There's sweet dreams.
Any last thoughts?
Not really. It's been a long evening and a long day.
And somebody's been drinking wine the whole time, so I'm sure she's ready to.
No. I didn't start drinking wine until about 7 o'clock tonight, but I've been up since 5:30.
I'm in during the whole show, but that's okay.
You know? No. I was drinking water. I drank wine before the show.
Yeah, but you drank water to keep the buzz, so same difference.
Wow.
I made sense, and I didn't slur.
I swear to drunk, I'm not God. I got God.
That reminds me of a bad joke, but we won't go there.
Well, listen.
Did I do a euphemism thing again? Because really,
you might have. No, you didn't.
A little bit.
I only swore twice.
That's okay. No, that's okay. Don't worry about it.
I know. Sweet. I was disappointed. I played the disclaimer for two swears. Well, then Jen dropped a couple, so I feel better now.
Yeah.
All right.
You hit your quota. Don't worry about it. If I could, there used to be a really, 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 really good show on the internet and on radio that used to say, it's time to shut this sucker down.
Yeah.
Was that mine?
No.
No.
Oh, okay.
I'm pretty sure it's the one that he used to do. I'm just saying.
We just say, hey, lady, you got the keys? Let's start up the car. We go, vroom.
Most things are about you, Stacey, but that one wasn't. It's okay, though.
Oh, Gene.
But we still love you. But we still love you. Because, the
share. All right, folks. All right, Rick.
Time to shut it down here.
All right, yep. Let's get out of here, folks. All right, this is going to do it for the special report right here tonight on KLRNradio.com. Regular programming will resume tomorrow. However, I'm off tomorrow night because I have an Easter program to do at the church, so I'll be back with you guys Monday. Stacey, why don't you plug your show on the way out, because you're going to be on Sunday, right?
Oh, absolutely. 8 p.m. EST with my good friend JD. We will be at Game On, 8 p.m.
And you can also check her out right here Monday night at 8 p.m. Eastern again on the Loftus Party. We'll see you guys later. Take care. And remember, in the words of both Bill S. Preston Esquire and Ted Theodore Logan, be excellent to each other. Have a great night. This is writing my poems for the few that look at me, took me, shook me, feeling me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins.